I request Manish to formally introduce Mr. Raghuraman and take it further.
Thank you, Hinesbhai. Good morning, friends.
Good morning.
Very good morning. We have Advocate E. Raghuraman, who has done a beautiful paper on the case studies on thermal credit mechanism, which is the most complicated topic as far as service tax is concerned. As far as Raghuraman is concerned, he is practicing advocate and a qualification chartered accountant also, practicing since last 23 years. He specializes in excise, custom, service tax, foreign trade policy, FEMA. He also undertake indirect tax planning and litigation and appear frequently before courts. He is a visiting faculty at IIM Bangalore as well as at CA Institute. He has addressed a large number of seminars and published several papers in national magazines on excise, custom and service tax. He is the author of a book, Landmark Decision in Indirect Taxation, published by CCH. He has authored a Central Excise Law and Procedure, published by R.K. Jain. And he has given background material on e-learning courses on service tax, which was published by ICM. With these few words, I welcome Advocate Raghuraman for the presentation of his paper. Thank you. Before that, I request Hinesh Doshi to kindly present a memento as a token of our love and appreciation to the paper.
Modified value-added tax, and
in the invoice system, which is essentially in Excise. In the invoice system came into vogue. We had modified credit cases coming up by the day, not by once in a while, by the day. So after 1994 to 1997, we had rechristened Modbat as Madbat. We were unable to handle litigation in Modbat, actually, to tell you the truth. And after Capital Goods Credit came, it only became worse. For a brief period, in the early 2000s, it was a little relaxed as far as credit mechanism was concerned. And we were quite happy that it looked to be settling till such time they undid the definitions of input service in 2011, which is a subject matter of one of the questions here also. So now we're probably back to handling more and more semi-credit matters. Therefore, this session will have some seminal importance to all of us. Now, let us look at the first question which is there. Really, the first question is on utilization of semi-credit. The issue is on utilization of semi-credit. I was happy to see that one of the groups had gone into availment also. Though that question was not asked, I think it was a Parvana group which I dealt with on availment also. In this question, essentially, the person who is availing the credit has availed certain credit on construction services, has also let out some portions of the property on rent. One of the issues that comes up in these matters is this. Supposing I construct a commercial property, I take the services of a contractor to construct the commercial property. After that, I leave it on rent. So, on the rental on the removal property services, I pay service tax. The issue is whether can we take credit on the contractor's service tax. That it becomes the issue. I hope you have understood the gamut. Can I set off the works contract tax that I have paid on the input side against the rental of immovable property which I receive on the output side? This is a short question which arises. There is a board circular, I understand, which has said you can't do it. There is a decision of the Andhra Pradesh High Court in Sai Samhita Storage 270 EAP, which says that the facts there were that they took credit on steel and cement. In fact, this case is on better footing than that case. They took a credit on steel and cement to build a warehouse. That warehouse was let out for warehousing services. Then the Andhra Pradesh High Court said, yes, without the steel and cement, you can't put up a warehouse. So, perfectly, you are entitled to credit. In this case also, the credit has been availed in 2010, validly availed. Can the credit be utilized? Is the question. So, all the three groups are unanimous on the fact that the credit can be utilized for payment on rental, for payment on construction activities. But when it comes to the reverse charge mechanism, the group says you cannot utilize the credit, but you should pay it by cash. Right? All three groups have said that. When it comes to reverse charge mechanism, you will have to necessarily pay the tax by cash. What is the reason for that? You have referred to an explanation under 3.4, which was inserted with effect from 1/7/2001. That explanation says that you cannot utilize the credit for payment if you are the service recipient. Right? One other question which I would like to pose to all of you is this. When I go under partial reverse charge mechanism, can it be said I am providing output service?
Partially.
Can it be said, is it no?
No.
Is it yes? Or is it half yes, half no, as somebody has told?
Yes.
Please look at the definition of output service. Please go ahead and see. Output service would tell you that it does not include a service on which the whole of the tax is payable by the recipient. Whole of the tax. Therefore, it becomes an output service. There is no question that there is no question of saying that it is partial output service. It is an output service, in my view. If that be the case, if a part of the tax is payable by the service recipient and only a part is payable by the service provider, will explanation to 3.4 work or not is the question. Are you following what I am saying? The explanation does not say whole of the tax payable by the service recipient. Please see explanation 3.4. I will come to both the arguments which can be made here. In 3.4, what does it say, the explanation? Well, tax is payable by the service recipient. So the department's argument should and would be that even if a portion of the tax is payable by you, you cannot utilize this as an credit. Well, our argument should be that if the tax is payable by both, the question of the tax being paid by the service recipient does not arise exclusively. And therefore, you should be able to utilize this as an credit. My view would be the latter, because we revel in litigation. We have to test this and see whether this 3.4 should be read along with the output service definition, or it should be read because this. I would say it should be read along with, and those who are under the partial reverse charge mechanism must be given the facility to use Sinbad credit for the purpose of payment. That is my view. Any questions on this? We come to the next question, which is fairly simple. I think all of you have come to the conclusion that when the asset is destroyed, there is an insurance claim that is paid to the person who avails an act credit. There's been a lot of disputes on this across the country, that when an insurance claim is received, the department says you should reverse the credit because there is a double benefit. On the one hand, you have got Sinbad credit. On the other hand, you have also got the insurance claim which covers the cost of the asset completely, including the Sinbad credit. So it's the department's view that you must reverse the Sinbad credit. All of you have taken a view that there is no need to reverse. That view is absolutely right for one reason. This I had an opportunity to argue the state before the Karnataka High Court. Tata Advanced Materials, 271 AD. I made only one submission. Kindly ask the department to show me which provision of CEDMAT credit rules requires me to reverse the credit when I get insurance claim. And they failed to do so. I just on a limited ground I won that matter. Nothing more than that. There is no statutory provision which says that because you receive insurance which includes the CEDMAT amount, you must reverse the credit. Simple proposition of law. Sometimes most complicated cases are run on most simple propositions of law. This is one. There was, however, a difference of opinion, I think, on the payment of 10,000 rupees which was discharged on the scab. There was one group which said that if an asset is put to use and then removed, the question of payment of tax will not arise because that is only applicable to removal of assets as such. That was one group. One of the groups said, I think they said specifically that rule applies only to manufacturers and not service providers. That's one view. This is the rather vexed question because we have been arguing these factors before the tribunal and it is pending. Whether these things, when they say specifically only manufacturer, whether it will apply to an output service provider, very clear. If the provision of law does not refer to a service provider at all, the question of attracting payment of tax doesn't arise. One, two, there is a difference between removal as such and removal after usage. When I use the goods and then subject it to removal, when I use the goods and then subject it to removal, then there is a usage. So what do you mean by as such and what do you mean by removal? When I get the goods, it is kept in my factory, let us say, for a couple of months. Can you say I have used the goods? Can it be said that I have used the goods? What do you mean by usage?
Consumption.
What do you mean by consumption? It is just lying there. Can I say it is used? If it is absolutely ready to use, but I am not able to use, what happens? What do you mean by good to use?
Intentionally
use. What do you mean? I have intentionally use, yes. Now, why I am asking you the questions is, these questions is, you are not sure what is asset and what is use. I will give you a parallel. It strikes me now, I will give you a parallel with section 74 of the Customs Act. If I import goods and re-export them, and the identity is established in the section 74 of the Customs Act, I am entitled to draw back up to 98%. There is a schedule there which says up to 98% you can claim drawback. The issue before the Karnataka High Court in Kelvin's case was whether an machinery which is imported for the purpose of exhibition, can you say that it is put to use? A fair exhibition is conducted in the country, machinery is imported. Nothing is done, it is just on display. After the exhibition completes, maybe 1 month or 1.5 months, it is re-exported. The assessee wanted to say that the machine is not at all put to use, which is what commonly you would think so. But the High Court said, no, no, no. your activity of putting the machine in a fair or exhibition is putting into use. Because you have imported it for the purpose of exhibition. That is use. Then it is, there is no doubt on those correct. There is absolutely no doubt that I have put it to use. Here is a question, man, it is lying there, I have not even touched it. So we may not have done. Why I am drawing the parallel from Customs Act is just to show you that there could be decisions on other legislations which have interpreted not used as such, almost similarly. But we need not be bound by the Customs Act decision we can distinguish it by saying that what is there in semi credit rules is when I actually put it to use as a manufacturer. This is one way of handling it. Unfortunately, in capital goods credit, if you see the difference in definition of inputs and capital goods which were there prior to 2011 and now, what is the difference? Has anybody noticed the difference after 2011 in the definition of inputs and especially inputs? Capital goods has remained more or less the same. In inputs, the earlier was it should be used in or in relation to manufacture. Today it should be used in the factory. Straight away, if you have goods which are used in the factory, it is your entitled for self-activated. And even if you have a remote connection to usage, because it says no connection whatsoever, that is how the inputs definition says. No connection whatsoever, that means a remote connection is also enough in inputs. So to answer this question, coming back, I would say that if you have put this, in my view, if you have issued anything to production, if you have put the facility in the production room, or in any part of your premises with the intention that it should be used, whether it is used or not, it is used. There is no removal as such. If you have put it in the production floor or capital goods, it is used. Whether you actually physically use it or not, it is used. And therefore, there is no removal as such. As such means absolutely or not used at all. So that would be my view on this. And therefore, I think you are right in saying on both accounts that the tax should not have been paid. Even the 10,000 rupees that they paid should not have been paid. The third question is very interesting. I was witness to some very agitated arguments on the third question. What really is the issue here? There is a job worker. Let us assume that I am the job worker. And you are the principal manufacturer. No, I am manufacturing certain goods for you. The process does not amount to manufacture. I send the goods to you, you are the principal manufacturer, you finish the goods and clear it on payment of duty. So I am claiming the exemption under 25 bar 2012, which is earlier 8 bar 2005. The issue is, can you call this as exempted clearances or exempted services? That is the issue. If you can call it as an exempted service, then I cannot retain the full semi-credit. If I can say this is not exempted services, then I can retain the credit and I need not go to rule 6 at all. This is the question. I had visited one of the groups, that is, I am told that among all the three groups, there are only two people who said that this will, there is no need to reverse. The rest of the group were very clear that it is an exempted.
Output.
Yes, It is exempted service because you are taking the benefit of 25 or 2005. I had an occasion to argue this matter before the tribunal. It is reported in TIOL, that is Tax India Online, 2013. MGM Screens case. Tax is similar. But that is for a manufacturer. But he is doing the same job. The two people whose, I don't know who those two people are. I think there's a, who are the two people? Right
there.
Please raise their hands. I can see him. He is the leader of which group was it? Parvanaru. Who was discussing Sterlite Industries last bench decision 183 AD. If I'm right. That is the paradise. There is a difference between clearance of under an exemption notification which is unconditional and which is conditional. If the notification is conditional, the clearance is not an exempted clearance or an exempted service. It becomes a taxable service subjected to a conditional exemption. In a job work, what we should explore is this, sir. Please look at rule 4 bracket 5. 4 bracket 5 of the semantic rules. If you look at 4 bracket 5 of the semantic rules, anything that is sent on job work to you is sent back to him on the condition that the principal manufacturer will be discharging the duty liability. That is also the condition in the notification 25/2005 or 8/2005 predecessor, that the principal manufacturer will discharge the duty. It is a conditional exemption. So, in Sterlite Industries, the same thing was argued, that when I clear something on a conditional exemption, what really happens if the exemption is not there? I pay the tax and he takes the credit. Simple. If you had told me, this is what I argued before the tribunal, let me put it in the same words. If you had visited and told me that tax was payable, I would have joyfully paid the tax and you are taking credit. What do you get out of it? Nothing. What does the department get out of it? Nothing. Because of whatever tax I pay, he takes credit. It's a revenue neutral situation. That is the reason why they have given this conditional exemption. So therefore, conditional exemptions, if you find any clearance against a conditional exemption notification, it is not an exempt service or an exempt clearance. It is a taxable clearance. And the provisions of Rule 6 will operate to include this as one of the taxable clearances. That is the ratio of the decisions, Sterlite Industries case. It was good to see the group leader being shut out literally in his arguments. It was difficult. I was just wondering, you know, if this department had really outshouted me in this, I would have found it difficult to argue the case. Nevertheless, the principle of law is this: if there is a conditional exemption, not an absolute exemption, it's a taxable service. The other issue which was raised incidentally was that can it be said that it is an absolute exemption or is it that we are forced to take an exemption notification? In service tax, are exemption notifications optional or are you forced to take it? See, in section 5A of the Excise Act, there are absolute exemption notifications which